Have you ever wondered how much nitrogen you need in flowering? Well, in this video, we're going to get into it. You're here with Mark Boutwell on Perfect Gardens TV. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Today, we got a special guest from Av Sai. This is actually a continuing conversation from the VPD conversation and the video you can check out here. But from that conversation, it stemmed into this conversation. I thought it was incredibly valuable. So let's go ahead and get into it. So let me go ahead and turn it over to Av.
If you haven't checked out our monthly membership, I highly recommend to do so. For only $2.99, you get access to over 1,570 photos, 162 videos, 10 files, 15 audio files, 562 shared links, and 86 members willing and ready to assist you through your growing practice. Make sure to hit the join button on the bottom of every video.
One thing we didn't talk about is that a lot of people will try to control, not necessarily VPD, but it does indirectly affect, is you know, using those oscillating fans. When you move a plant that much, you are definitely affecting their VPD. There's no question. And so some people use that as a technique. I don't typically recommend it because of so many other things.
That was actually 2 points you brought up. And you said that at the leaf, the 83 at the temperature of the leaf when using CO2 and ambient air then means your ambient air is warmer.
It's hard to tell whether that is the case for LEDs, right?
Mm-hmm. Because light intensity versus heat. Absolutely. Yeah. And, you know, what we're discussing is chemical reaction on the leaf surface that's creating heat in that experience. Right or wrong?
Maybe explain that to me a bit more.
Well, okay. All right, so I'm a flat earther. If anyone watches this fucking thing, okay. Doesn't matter. So I'm always challenging light. And what we're discussing is there's a lot of heat that comes off of an HID system. There's a lot of light that comes off of the LED. Yeah. And then I just asked you, so your ambient air is warmer, but then you're like, because we're using LEDs. And so then when you look at your leaf, is that LED creating a chemical reaction that's heating the surface of the leaf, but not increasing the temperature of the environment?
Mainly that's coming through infrared, right?
Mm-hmm.
Infrared is your radiant heat.
The little gun thing.
Right.
Yep.
Sorry. Like just in general, like radiant heat. So there's very little radiant heat coming from that LED, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in one of the biggest challenges when people switch from an HID or, you know, typically HPS to an LED is that they run their rooms at the same temperature that they used to, right? So if you ran your room for HPS, you might run your rooms at 75 or 70. Mm-hmm. Is that normal?
Absolutely. No. Okay. Yeah. So the other room, and I'm always looking at their dial, like the basic dial that they're hanging in the room. Normally they only have one. And that's what I'm dealing with. And just up to the other day, it was 74. And then I had them increase it to 77. Now I'm going to probably have him increase it a little bit warmer. Well, he's not using CO2. So I'll probably go back to the VPD chart and adjust based upon there.
But the main thing is, like, whenever you increase those temperatures, you may have to actually increase the amount of moisture given to that plant, right? Because it is going to transpire more. And if it's transpiring more, it may move a lot more nutrients. So you may have to think about adding, you know, some more nutrients if your VPD is happening. Mm. The opposite can happen, right? So we can create nutrient lockout by having a very low VPD. And if we still have that same nutrient concentration, we're pumping in a bunch of nutrients. The plant's not transpiring. You've screwed up the pH of the root zone now because you've got way more nutrients and no transpiration happening. So now you've created nutrient lockout.
You just kind of connected something. Remember when I hope I listened to you properly on that. Remember when I sent you that picture and the EC was 8.9 or something like that? It was crazy high. And you're like, your EC should be normally 5. And I was like, this is microbiology. And it's really interesting because it was colder room, so the VPD would be higher, right?
Lower. No, it might be lower.
Lower.
It might be lower.
And if the plant isn't transpiring as much, then more, if the microbiology is unlocking more of that nutrients, it would possibly create a higher EC in the root system.
Right.
Because it's not transpiring as much.
Exactly.
Wow.
That leads nutrient lockout, right? And quite the opposite in nutrient burn, which I've just recently done in my room, because my humidity dropped quite a bit. My VPD, my temperatures were high, humidity was low. Therefore, my VPD was really high, right? It was probably over 1.7. It probably was 1.9. And I got nutrient burn because the plant was drying out too much, closing its stomates. Nutrients were collecting right there without a lot of water, because the water would have kept the nutrients more in balance, less toxic amounts. And so I did the opposite of creating a nutrient lockout. I created nutrient burn because I didn't have the right VPD.
Could having such a high EC in that situation, then you would adjust the temperature to increase, maybe I'm repeating what you just say, but could it end up causing nutrient lockout or toxicity because I'm then taking the nutrients from that soil system that has a high heat EC? And
I mean, in large part, much of that EC is probably governed by potassium, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so what's interesting is potassium actually is one of the main things that regulates the stomates opening and closing, right? You still need energy. You still need phosphorus to help push the open and close those, but it's potassium that actually regulates the opening of the sort of like eyelids of the stomate. So the nice part is that if you could increase your VPD to the point where now you are actually taking up nutrients and transpiring, so the plant is now transpiring, hopefully a lot of what's coming into that plant is in fact potassium, right? And so that potassium will then, you know, which is probably okay for a flowering plant, right? Because we do typically need a fair amount of potassium in there, as long as it's in balance with nitrogen. We want that to happen.
This would make a lot of sense too, because like when I make my soils, I always put Langanite in the beginning. And then as we go later into flowering, I take some of the pre-mixed soil they already have, perfectly knowing that the nitrogen's probably been denitrified or evaporated back in the environment, but it still has the basic makeup. Then I encourage to add in more Langanite, which is more K. Yeah. And then I tell them to add a top layer of soil and water that in, right? And that makes a lot of sense what you're doing on running that CO2. Something kind of came to me a little bit, you can increase the Langanite toward flowering and the CO2 because it's opening up those stomatas more efficiently and you're running that CO2. Am I connecting something there?
Well, I mean, No question that you do need that potassium for stomatal regulation,
but it's
potassium is so valuable in all other aspects too, right? Because you do need your K and N have to be at that one-to-one balance going into flowering to really drive proper Brix levels as well, right? So if you have a disproportionate amount, and sometimes we don't have enough nitrogen in our flowering phase because we totally forget about it and we get way too much potassium. Like we add our seaweed extract and we add our potassium sulfate and we might add our langbeinite. So now we've got three big sources of potassium, not enough nitrogen. And then we can sway that balance and to the point where you've got way too much potassium, not enough nitrogen. And now your Brix levels will actually drop in your plant as well.
When you say a one-to-one, what does that mean, one-to-one? Does that mean like on the box when it says NPK? Yeah. So then are you saying, so we mix it in all of our amendments in the beginning, yeah, and pomeol, whatever it is, right? And then normally there's going to be a lot of calcium in that mix in the beginning.
Yeah.
And wow, you're dumping on some really interesting stuff here.
I think a lot of people will use calcium nitrate in flowering to make sure that they continue to get nitrogen. I would rather use amino acids, right? So that's where I'm not as comfortable. We don't typically use calcium nitrate up here in organic, right? You can use it there.
What amino acids do you like to use?
So I would probably use a fish hydrolysate, or okay, I would use, maybe a soy isolate, something like that. Yeah.
for when in flowering to create. Okay. So that's what I was going to ask you. So you make your amendments when you're in veg. That's that one thing. But when you're going into flowering, you're talking about needing a one-to-one ratio with nitrogen and potassium.
Yeah. And we do this based on tissue tests, right? So we're doing this on a tissue, like a tissue test, not a sap analysis, not a soil test, but on a tissue test, we want to make sure that we're still getting enough nitrogen to keep the potassium sort of in balance. But there's a lot more, like, you know, in veg, there's going to be a lot more nitrogen. It's going to be probably like a 1.3-to-1 ratio where there's more nitrate to potassium. And then we get down to a closer to 1-to-1 ratio. But it's different forms of nitrogen typically too, right? So where I might use nitrate nitrogen in veg, I might use a more ammonia-based nitrogen in
a slow in release. A slow release nitrogen.
Exactly. But when we mix our soils, this is a guess for me too. So I'll use hen manure as hen manure, maybe some blood meal, maybe a bit of soy as more of my
veg
nitrogen, right? So it's going to be in a proportion that will kind of be used up in 4 to 5 weeks in my mind. And then of course I'm going to have feather meal, alfalfa meal, insect frass, crab meal, which are probably going to be more my ammonia based nitrogens. And they were probably going to become more available come in the, you know, hopefully in the last 8 weeks type thing.
Okay. So I think you patched that right for me. So you have your more immediately available nitrogen in veg, but then your amendments that you're using that are, like you're saying, that are more the ammonia, the slow release nitrogens, you're banking on, like, you're kind of aware of your numbers inputs of your NPK in the beginning. And then you're like, okay, I put in this much langanite also in the beginning. So that probably used up some of these. Well, it probably used up the other nitrates. So yeah, I still have the slow release in there.
So langbeinite wouldn't have any nitrogen, right?
No. I'm talking about potassium.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Potassium. Sure. So, but I'm thinking that langanite used up by the nitrates. The
bone meal, that stuff. If you want to say it that way, yes. Yes.
And then the slow release nitrogen you have, you have those counts. Let's say it ends up adding up to X amount. Then you kind of want to add in an additional ratio of langanite to that topsoil to equal out what you probably put in the beginning, and then equal it out the fish if you're estimating it to be low or see it in a deficiency or toxic deficiency of some level.
And it is so much easier to do a bit more of that using compost extracts and teas, right? Or something in second week of flower where I might do something that's going to have more potassium sulfate, right? I might do a tea that's going to have more potassium because it's so much easier to monitor that than to try to dial it in by mixing. Like, so my potassium sources are typically going to be something like alfalfa meal, kelp meal, potassium sulfate, as well as K-Mag or langbeinite. Those would be my main potassium sources. And I have to kind of have that, knowing that potassium sulfate is probably going to be my quickest release of potassium. You know, something like a kelp would be a slower release, or an alfalfa would be a slower release. So,
wow, man, that is, you know.
And then, you know, you could add a bunch of microbes. And if you added, instead of adding 50 grams, you added 100 grams, that could throw everything off.
Right? Law of minimum, law of tolerance. Absolutely. You're adjusting. But I know I can get more from my growers. I know I can advise them better. For me, I'm taking, in my opinion, pre-existing knowledge I've had a long time ago, and I'm injecting into growers that don't really have that right anymore. So I'm a couple chapters ahead, and it's so hard for me to want to deviate from something that has, I know it, we've had some downfalls, but it wasn't because of our growing. It was because of legality reasons, right? So it's like, it's hard for me to want to deviate from that, because at that time, I didn't have anyone that was talking like you to me, right? It was like me talking to a whole bunch of other people like you talk to me. And now I want to try what you're telling me, because it seems like we have similar belief structures around these things.
And you know, so much has changed, right? And you're still dealing with two very different subsets, right? Where HPS growers grow this way and LED growers have to grow this way. And it's trying to combine the two. Too, right? Mm-hmm. Because they're getting a lot of traditional knowledge that says, you know, plants are going to do way better at 72 degrees, and they might under HPS, right? But under LED, you grow under 72 and you've got larfy bud, you've got low yields, and you're thinking, why the fuck did I buy LEDs when I should have been under HPS, right? But if you increased your temperature, you know, and that's what most people, or you know, increase light intensity, whatever, maybe the light spectrum and all that. And it's I mean, that's the hardest thing about consulting, is that you want to ask 100 other questions than the 10 bits of information they tell you.
Absolutely.
You need to, you know, say, oh yeah, but what temperature are you watering your plants at? Oh, okay. Yeah. That makes a big difference. Okay. Oh, you're using oscillating fans. Yeah. Well, tell me what the temperature is right when you're in front of the oscillating fan, and then tell me the temperature in the back of the room. Yeah. There's your powdery mildew, right? You know, so those are all those things that very difficult for you to be able to do over the phone and video.
No, you're 100% right. You know, I have my key questions that I'm able to eliminate about 80% of the fat from, but yeah, a lot of the times the growers, they won't clean the lens off. They'll send me a blurry picture. They'll send me a vertical picture versus it's a horizontal picture, so I can see a little bit more. They'll get really up close to one problem in the plant and neglect all the other plants in the room. So, but you have guided me a lot in the last 2-3 times we have connected, to help me adjust my eyes to what I'm looking at and to what to pay attention to. And that was my bread and butter. I had my clothes. I have a certain wardrobe I wear when walking into a room, because if I don't,
That's so true. That's so true, right? Because when you walk into a room, there's so much information that comes to you. Mm-hmm. That you probably wouldn't recognize, like you can't name it.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't name that your eye has just seen 100 different points.
Exactly.
That says that's been overwatered. That plant was overwatered in its lifetime, right? They never showed you that picture. Yeah. But now that you've seen it, you recognize, okay, so they may have a shitty root system here.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So now we're dealing with a shitty root system because it's been overwatered. A shitty root system is not going to bring up those nutrients as much as a healthy root system. Right. And, you know,
you're 100% right, brother, man. We just thank you for this second little piece of content. I really appreciate this, man.
Seriously. No, likewise. I love to, continue developing my skills too, in terms of one, trying to explain some of this too, right? Because you want to explain it in a way that makes sense to both a mechanical engineer.
As well as
a grower, right? Because that's and I don't always understand HVAC well enough, right? So for me, it is important that I say I want these environmental conditions. Can you make it so?
Mm-hmm.
If I left it up just to an environmental engineer, they would give me, you know, 400 tons of cooling when I needed 600, because the 400 is based on just a VPD chart, and they can deliver me that same VPD at 70 degrees and 65% relative humidity that I would want at 80 degrees and 55. But if I don't tell them I want the 80 degrees, they'll give me the 70 degrees. And I'll have the same VPD, but now my CO2 efficiency is going to be much lower and I might get powdery mildew. So if I don't tell them that, if I just told them I want a VPD of 1.2, they can do it at a much lower cost. They will do it and it's going to be set for 70 degrees and 65 humidity. And that's my 1.2. But
that's what we were talking about just a second ago.
Yeah, I forgot to tell them that, oh, I want 80 degrees at my minimum.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that type of stuff, right?
Bro, thank you. Yeah. Once again, for your time today. You're the best, man. I learned so much from you.
Likewise. So I'm looking forward to more of these.
Okay. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Have a great grow, everyone.
It was like, well, you know, I've been shaking my water, you know, 15 minutes before. And I showed him the video. I was like, you know, I understand, you know, there's different methods, but by far, this is going to be the simplest way. It's you don't have to shake it. I mean, if you have it in a 5-gallon bucket, that's already a lot of work.
That's a lot of work.